1917 battles its way out of the trenches to take number one. Oscar 2020 nominations are out. Bad Boys for Life and Doolittle in the 15 or 2. And the rest of the top 10. Let's go. Welcome back to Stone & Watch Wkend Box Office. Let's just dive right into it. For coming in for number one this week, all the way up from 17, we got 1917. They're bringing $37 million for their weekend haul. They're up like a little over 5,800% from last week. Their total domestic as of right now is $39.7 million, and its worldwide is sitting at $66.6 million. And coming in at number two this week, we got Star Wars The Rise of Skywalker. They're bringing $15 million for their weekend haul. They're down 56% from last week. Their total domestic as of right now is $478.2 million, and its worldwide is sitting at $996.5 million. And they come in number three this week. We got Jumanji to the next level. They're bringing $14 million for their weekend haul. They're down almost 47% from last week. Their total domestic as of right now is $257 million, and its worldwide is sitting at $661.9 million. Coming at number four this week and debuting on the chart, we've got Like a Boss. They're bringing $10 million for their weekend haul. That's their total domestic as of right now, and its worldwide is sitting at $10.9 million. And they come at number five this week, all the way up from 30, we've got Just Mercy. They bring in $9.7 million for their weekend haul. They're up almost 12,000% from last week. Their total domestic as of right now is $10 million, and they do not have a worldwide box office as of this point. And coming at number six, we got Little Women. They're bringing $7.8 million for their weekend haul. They're down almost 43% from last week. Their total domestic as of right now is $74 million, and its worldwide is sitting at $108 million. And coming at number seven and debuting on the chart this week, we've got Underwater. Now they're bringing $7 million for their weekend haul. Their total domestic as of right now is $7 million, and its worldwide is sitting at $14.9 million. And coming to number eight, we got Frozen 2. They're bringing $5.9 million for their weekend haul. They're down a little over 50% from last week. Their total domestic as of right now is $459.5 million, and its worldwide is sitting at $1.3 billion. That's what the B. Actually, they're almost up to 1.4. And coming at number nine, we've got Knives Out. They bring in $5.6 million for their weekend haul. They're down almost 37% from last week. Their total domestic as of right now is $139.5 million, and its worldwide is sitting at $256.9 million. And rounding out our top 10, we got Spies in Disguise. They bring in $5 million for their weekend haul. They're down almost a little over 50% from last week. Their total domestic as of right now is $54.6 million, and its worldwide is sitting at $116 million. Wow, I mean, that's just something else. Now, 1917 and Just Mercy, man, like they just like jumped up into the top 10 from one week to the other. Now, I think originally I saw that 1917, he only had like 11 screens like a week or so ago. And so they added on like a little over 3,400 screens. So that's going to affect your box office, right? And obviously it affected it in the most positive way you can get. I mean, you go from 17 to number one. It's pretty damn cool and what have you. Now, I still have yet to see it, but I'm hearing really good things about it. So, I don't know. I did see Rise of Skywalker again a couple weeks ago, and I like it a little bit better than I did the first time. But that's just a little bit better than the first time. I'm still working on the review video, so kind of watch out for that and what have you. And they are inching their way closer to a billion. I mean, $996 billionaires. They're almost like $4 million more, and they are a $1 billion film. Within about a month. That's pretty damn cool. I'm sure Disney's going to be happy as all hell that it reached a billion. Now, it's still less than Last Jedi. I think Last Jedi got up to like $1.4, $1.5 billion and what have you. So, I don't know. Let's see how close it actually gets. It's only like within the fourth weekend. So, anything can happen, but I don't really think it's going to get really much higher. I think it's going to top out. Now, this is just my little prediction. I got no inside from information. You know, I'm just guessing, but I'm going to say it's going to top out maybe 1.2 at the most $1.3 billion when it's all said and done in its theatrical release. That's just I'm just guessing. That's what I'm thinking. So I don't know. Did you see The Rise of Skywalker yet? How many times have you seen it? Have you gone and seen 1917? I'm hearing really good things about it. A friend of mine, from work and what have you, he said to go see it, and he also said to go check. He also said to go check out They Shall Not Grow Old. It's on Netflix, and it kind of ties in with the 1970 history storyline and what have you. So I haven't checked it out myself personally, but I'm going to probably like either before or after see the movie. So I'll have to verify whether or not if it's like something you need to see before the movie or something you see after the movie. I'm not really sure where it actually. So I'll get back to you on that one. So anyway, something to keep in mind. So I don't know. Did you see any of these movies in the top 10? Let me know in the comments down below. Now it's time for Stone and Watts 15 or 2. All right, let's just dive right into it now. Come on, number one for 15 or 2 this week, we've got Bad Boys for Life. Now, they're calling it an action, comedy, crime, thriller. Now, the description reads, the Bad Boys, Mike Lowry and Marcus Burnett, are back together for one last ride in the highly anticipated Bad Boys for Life. Now, this movie is being directed by Eddie L. Arby Bali Fala, starring Will Smith, Martin Lawrence, Vanessa Hutchinson, Alexander Ludwig and Joe Pantoliano, to mention a few. Now, I just watched the trailer for this thing for the first time a few minutes ago, actually, again, and I think it was an updated trailer, and it looks pretty damn good. Now, I don't know if I'm going to rush out and go and see it opening weekend and what have you, because I'm not really like a big, huge Bad Boys fan. I mean, I seen the other two movies. I kind of remember them, to be quite honest with you, and they were good, but they didn't really... they weren't Star Wars or anything, you know what I'm saying? So, I mean, I might go check it out. So, when I see it, if I see it, you know what I'm going to say? I'm going to say matinee at the most. I mean, it looks pretty damn good. Looks like it's got a lot of action and stuff. It looks like there's a lot of good one-liners. Hopefully, that's not all in the trailer. So, I don't know. Did you see the trailer for Bad Boys for Life? You can go and check this movie out. Let me know in the comments down below. Second on the list for 15 or 2, we've got Doolittle. Now, they're calling it adventure, comedy, family, fantasy. Now, the description reads, a physician discovers that he can talk to the animals. Now, this movie is being directed by Stephen Gahan. Sorry if I butcher your name, man. And starring Robert Downey Jr., Antonio Banderas, Michael Sheen, and Jim Broadbent, to name a few. Now, I just watched the trailer for the same for the first time a few minutes ago, and I have to say, yeah, it looks pretty good. Now, I don't know if I'm going to rush out and go see it opening weekend and what have you, but it looks pretty good. I mean, it's a totally different take. I mean, when I first saw this thing and it said Doolittle, I thought it was like another remake of like the Eddie Murphy movie and what have you, but it's not. I mean, it's not. It's totally different than what I thought it was actually going to be. So it looks pretty good. Now, when I see it, if I see it, you know, I'm going to say matinee the most, because that's just because I'm cheap. But other than that, it does look pretty good. Now, I'm not going to go rush out and go see it opening weekend most likely, but it does look pretty good. So did you see the trailer for Doolittle? You want to check this movie out? Let me know in the comments down below. Third on the list this week, we've got The Wave. Now, they're calling it a sci-fi. Now, the description reads, Frank, an opportunist insurance lawyer, thinks he's in for the time of his life when he goes out on the town to celebrate an upcoming promotion with his co-worker, Jeff. But their night takes a turn for a bizarre when Frank is dosed with a hallucinogen that completely alters his perception of the world, taking him on a psychotic quest through board meetings, nightclubs, shootouts, alternative dimensions. As Frank ping-pongs between reality and fantasy, he finds himself on a mission to find a missing girl, himself, and his wallet. Now, this movie is being directed by Gil Kelvin, starring Justin Long, Tommy Flanagan, Kata Winner, and Donald Faison. Now, I just watched the trailer thing for this thing for the first time a few minutes ago, and I have to say this movie looks trippy. I mean, that's the only way I can really describe it. This thing looks messed up, dude. I mean, I don't know. When I see it, if I see it, you know what I'm going to say? I'm going to say matinee the most. It doesn't look bad. It looks actually pretty damn good, but I think I might want to watch this one at home just in case if I start, you know, getting flashbacks or something. You know what I'm saying? I mean, I don't know. I mean, it looks pretty good. So, I don't know. Did you see the trailer for Wave? You can go check this movie out. I think this movie looks trippy. That's just me. What do you think? Let me know in the comments down below. And finally, for 15 or 2 this week, we've got VH Yes. Now, they're calling it a comedy. Now, the description reads, a bizarre retro comedy shot entirely on VHS and beta follows a 12-year-old Ralph who accidentally records home videos and his favorite late-night shows over his parents' wedding tape. Now, this movie is being directed by Jack Henry Robbins, starring Kerry Kennedy, Thomas Lennon, Mark Parch, and Courtney Presario. Sorry if I butchered your name. Now, I just watched the trailer for this thing for the first time a few minutes ago, and I have to say, it looks pretty damn funny. Now, I'm not going to go rush out and see this opening weekend. And if I see it, when I see it, you know I'm going to sing with a matinee the most. And I'm actually really leaning towards more like the $2 at home range, to be quite honest with you. I mean, it looks funny. It doesn't look totally terrible and what have you, but I just can't really see paying money to see that in one of the theater. I don't know. That's just me. I don't know. It looks funny. And it's different. I mean, you give them credit. It's a totally different thing, especially what they do nowadays. So I don't know. Did you see the trailer for VHS? Yes, you're going to check this movie out? Let me know in the comments down below. The trailer for Morbius dropped earlier today. Now, I just watched this thing for the first time a few minutes ago, and I have to say it looks pretty damn weird for a comic book movie. Now, this one's being directed by Daniel Espinosa, starring Jared Harris, J.K. Simmons, and Jared Leto. And I also saw in there was Michael Keaton. Now, I looked in the cast and stuff like that listing, and they're not saying what character he's playing. So I'm kind of wondering if he's playing that guy that was Vulture in Spider-Man Homecoming. Well, maybe. I think maybe that's how they're going to tie one of the ways they're going to tie all these movies together other than J.K. Simmons. So, I don't know, that'd be kind of interesting to find that out. Now, the description reads that biochemist Michael Morbius tries to cure himself of a rare blood disease, but inadvertently he infects himself in a form of vampirism instead. Now, I'm not really all that familiar with this comic book, to be quite honest with you. I saw it when I was a kid, but it didn't really strike me as something I really wanted to read because it kind of, you know, it's a horror movie and it kind of goes like along with it. So I don't know. I'm not saying it looks terrible. It looks kind of interesting. So I don't know. I don't know. I have to wait and see it. Now, this one's coming out July 21st of 2020, so I have to wait and see how this plays out. So I don't know. Did you see the trailer for Morbius? Let me know in the comments down below. The 2020 Oscar nominations are out. Now, this is going to air on ABC on February 9th at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time or 5 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. Check your local listings for your channel. Now, our Best Picture nominations this year, we got Ford v. Ferrari, The Irishman, Jojo Rabbit, Joker, Little Women, Marriage Story, 1917, Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, and Parasite. Nominated for Best Actor this year, we've got Antonio Banderas for Pain and Glory, Leonardo DiCaprio for Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, Adam Driver comes in for Marriage Story, Joaquin Phoenix gets nominated for Joker, and we got Jonathan Pryce gets nominated for The Two Popes. Nominated for Best Actress this year, we have Cynthia Erivo for Harriet, Scarlett Johansson is nominated for Marriage Story, we got Saoirse Ronan coming in for Little Women, Charlize Theron for Bombshell, Renee Zellweger nominated for Judy. Nominated for Best Supporting Actor this year, we've got Tom Hanks for A Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood, Anthony Hopkins for Two Popes, Al Pacino for The Irishman, Joe Pesci for The Irishman, and we got Brad Pitt coming in for Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. Best Supporting Actress this year, we have Kathy Bates for Richard Jewell, Laura Dern for Marriage Story, Scarlett Johansson comes in with the second nomination for Jojo Rabbit, Florence Pugh for Little Women, and Margaret Robbie for Bombshell. Best Animated Feature Film, we have How to Train Your Dragon, The Hidden World, I Lost My Body, Claws, The Missing Link, and Toy Story 4. Nominations for Best Cinematography this year, we've got Rodrigo Pietro for The Irishman, Lawrence Shear for The Joker, Jaron Blankenship for The Lighthouse, Roger Deakins for 1917, and Robert Richardson for Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. Now, I'll leave a link for the rest of the category nominations in the description down below, because if I try to list them all off here, I'll be here all damn day. So, I don't know. I don't really have any favorites, but I can tell you, I have noticed there's a lot of Netflix movies on this list. A lot of Netflix movies, man. They have a really, really good chance this year of taking home an Oscar. Now how big of a bragging right would that be if a streaming service wins an Oscar? I think that's pretty damn interesting and pretty damn cool to see if that actually happens. I mean, this is history in itself, right? I mean, there's like at least four or five movies that I've seen on here from Netflix that are nominated for an Oscar. So I don't know. You got any favorites this year for the Oscars? Let me know in the comments down below. I don't know, man. It was one crazy weekend. We had some really crazy weather going on here up in Michigan and what have you. I don't know about where you're at, but we had a lot of rain stuff. It almost got flooded out Saturday, so I don't know. It's pretty damn crazy. I ended up staying inside the house and pretty much watching movies most of the day, so that was kind of cool a little bit. Saw Aladdin over the weekend. I'll help put a review video up for that here shortly and what have you, so keep an eye out for that one. Morbius trailer dropped today. Now, that looks kind of interesting and stuff like that. And again, now I'm not that really knowledgeable on the story for that comic book, to be quite honest with you. I really want to know what that Michael Keaton character is going to be from Spider-Man Far From Home. If that's going to be one of like the linchpins that they're going to use to help tie all this stuff together. That'd be kind of interesting to find that out. Bad Boys Doolittle in 15 or 2 this week. They look pretty damn good. Now, that Wave movie looks pretty damn trippy. I mean, trippy. VHS, I don't know about that one. That looks like something I would do back when I was a kid and what have you, but it looks all right. I doubt it. I mean, I'm leaning more to like watching that one at home, to be quite honest with you. The Oscar 2020 nominations are out. Those are pretty damn interesting to see who's going to win that. Now, Netflix has got a lot of nominations on that thing, so they have a good chance of winning an Oscar. I think that's pretty damn interesting. I hope to see if anybody else really brings that up. 1917 dropping up all the way from position 17. Now, they add a lot of screens, so that's mainly a lot of it. But to go all the way up to number one, that's pretty damn amazing. Now, again, Rise of Skywalker for like the last 4 weeks since being released, like every week it drops like almost 50, some odd little over almost 60% like every single week. So I'm not really all that. I'm a little shocked that it's 1917 that took number one, but I'm not really shocked that something took number one by seeing how that every single week Rise of Skywalker jumps down, drops down like a little over 50%, almost 60% every single week. So, but they are almost to a billion. They're almost there. So like maybe in the next week or two, they might make it. I don't know. They're slowing down. They're kind of like really front end heavy, just like almost every other movie from last year, right? So I don't know. Jumanji's really slowing down, but they're still in the top five. And we've got Like a Boss and Just Mercy fighting it out for position 4 and 5. Let's see how that plays out with the actuals when they come out later. So I don't know. It's pretty damn crazy, man. Pretty damn crazy. Now, I just wanted to bring this up also. Unfortunately, over the weekend, drummer for Rush, Neil Peart, dies at 67. Now, that's a damn shame. He's like pretty much like, as far as I'm concerned, and most people are concerned, he's probably like the best damn drummer that's in the business and what have you. I mean, he did a lot. I mean, that was pretty much, you know what I mean? If you could play just as good, half as good as Neil Peart, you're a pretty damn good drummer. You know what I'm saying? So it's a damn shame he had to go so soon. I mean, I didn't even know he was sick. I guess, like, according to the reports and stuff like that, he died of fighting brain cancer after 2.5 years. So I guess that would explain why they were retiring from touring and what have you not too long ago. So I guess they had something to do with it, but they didn't really say why. So I have to wait and see. So that's just a damn shame. So I don't know, man. I don't know. It's a major bummer, man. I mean, it just goes to show you got to really pay attention, you know, because you never know, man. You just never know. One day that people that you know and love and look up to or look like they're okay, and next thing you know, they're gone. So, you know, anybody that you have in your life and what have you, hold on to them tight because you never know. They can just, they're here one day and gone the next. It just kind of sucks. So in honor of Mr. Neil Peart, I'm going to close out the show today with The Limelight. Now, I'm not getting monetized anyway, so I'm not really worried about it. They hit me up with the copyright. So I'll see you in the next video, people. Peace. In time, living.